We lost a lot of talented individuals in the streets of Chicago.
16-year-old Elijah Sims was shot Monday in Tuesday morning.
More than 460 homicides in a...
Look at the skyline, it's beautiful. You think about how beautiful they...
Choose another life that was gone too young.
And only getting worse for...
Yeah.
August was the most violent month in...
You can't really come outside at night.
Get this, the murder rate in Chicago is higher than New York City and Los Angeles combined.
Who in the hell is gonna pay for this blood in the streets?
Blood in the streets.
The two worshipers should be heard when they pray to the peace.
Many are just innocent victims of the horrific gang violence rolling through their neighborhoods.
The streets.
The prophets is back in the earth and they going up the teeth.
Shalom, this is our Most High Christ Blessed. This is Sergio Riel with the Chicago Camp. What we're doing right now, we are preparing about 5,000 flyers for our people here today at the Bud Billiken Day Parade, which is the largest parade, the so-called African-American parade in the country. So we're preparing flyers right now, about 5,000, feeding the people, our brothers, a slight brunch, preparing for breakfast, fellowshipping, boots on the ground here in Chicago for the Bud Billiken Day Parade. So if you wasn't here this year, then Lord's will, you make it next year. All right? Come put the brick in, come put the work in, because we need it. You know? With that, signing off. Stay tuned. Shalom.
4,500 Americans were killed in Iraq. This many in Afghanistan. More have been killed in Chicago since 2001 than in both wars combined.
You can kill it like Osama, yeah.
Death before Osama.
Not no more. Not no more.
Take care of our wives.
Take care of our wives.
And our children too.
And our children too.
We have repented.
In your time being in Chicago, what would you say has changed since you were a youth, about your kids' age, up until now in your adult life? Have things changed for the better?
Yes, you see more, it's more apparent, the propagation or indoctrination of like the music, sabotage of music. You see the same education. Curriculums aren't being fine-tuned to us, for us to like them. So it makes it apparent that it's mind control. You know what I mean? So that's what's more apparent. The apparent that I'm trying to sabotage our culture, sabotage our race, making sure it's a lot of phone stores, but we're not getting great information from classrooms. What are people talking about if you're not giving us good information, great information? You get what I'm saying?
Right. So what things have you seen change for the better?
You know what I've noticed? I told with this, the new generation of children, they're more so into their hair, the nappy. Like the nappy, growing up, when I was coming up, nappy wasn't cool, it wasn't good, you know, because they saw all the programming, the be white, this and that, whatever. So the new generation, they haven't felt that, you know, all that, hey, you ain't this and that, or whatever, your hair ain't this and that. They embrace their naps, they embrace their hair better, like they all the different styles, because they haven't been really taught that their hair isn't good. You get what I'm saying? The new generation, so they know how to embrace it. But like I just say, my generation on up, like my parents and whatnot, they've been programmed that nappy is not good. So the best thing I see today is kids embracing nappy, and that's a good thing, because it's you. They embrace themselves well.
Yep. So basically what you're saying is that the newer generation is starting to learn who they are?
Yes, I would say so. If it's not too much of a programming. When it's programming, then they get away from themselves. But I would say that. That's about the best thing I've seen thus far.
Well, where does that programming come from?
To hate, self-hate, right. government.
In what ways?
Media, let's say TV, the type of person that you showing up, that's gonna be the star or whatnot. You don't see too much black, they showing too much black, it symbolized too much power. So they always have to show someone that's conforming, or someone that's conforming for a check or conforming for a dollar, you know.
And in what ways would you say that that actually affects, like, your children of this age?
They base everything off money. That meaning I'm willing to do whatever for the dollar, but oppression sets the stage for all of that.
Based on what they see in the media?
Yeah, if I oppress you and I tell you that, for example, guys are more so willing to rap about killing each other than rap about harming each other because it cuts a check. So a lot of the guys not living that life, but it cuts a check. So since it's cutting a check, that's why they're doing it. But so the industry, slave master, has set it up to where it's, oh, okay, well, this is what I'll pay for. I'll pay for you all to rap about killing each other, because now what that's going to do is it means more money. You get locked up. And then I just got through watching something yesterday where they was talking about how the prison system backs up the mortgage company, the banks or whatever. So it's just so many different ways that we're sabotage. I call it ass. That's apparent systematic sabotage. That's what the school is. That's what the justice system is. You got so many different things to where we're behind, whether it's the courts backing a woman up for injustice. You know, like we can't get to what the police doing to us because we still doing it, and it'll never make sense. Like, you showing what a cop is doing to us, but if they want to show a world, like a the best of world star, us on us, you know what I mean? So now we have to start with just black on black love first, you know, like love us first, because we the best, best, we dancers. Athletes, we jumping out the gym, we the fastest, we have soul. So that's why they want to own it, and that's why they have to, like I was telling somebody a little while ago, like, look at how the churches are to have a constant people reporting it every Sunday. Why isn't that the churches aren't the first sign of communion, meaning are able to come out and show people, like, no, like, we God's people. How is all of this happening when you got all these churches? Like, you got churches next door. This pastor don't mess with this pastor.
So let me ask you, would you say that the churches, do they participate in the destruction?
Yes, that is, because if you babysitting them and you're not giving them survival, you're not giving them real love. I'm going to drop this one on you. The church is supposed to be for spirit, right? But what carries your spirit, your body? The church is the number one out of shape place. I'm a trainer. All the church people are out of shape. So how you gonna carry that spirit in that body if the pastor doesn't preach health? It's the so-called preaching spirit. But no, you can't preach spirit without preaching body. They don't preach anybody. So now everybody that's in the church overweight, too tired. You too tired to serve. You too lazy to serve. And then why isn't the sermon important to the ladies in the kitchen cooking the chicken, the fried chicken, for when everybody get out of church? You get what I'm saying? So it's all system. We need to tear all this down, and all these systems we undermine, and we need to be under our own. Like, for example, today, the parade.
Right.
The police are rude. Rude in the sense of they're standing guard, but they're not all sociable. They need to be out of the way. They're actually in the way. The children can't really perform. It's just not enough assistance. It's not enough assistance.
And so if you had the power, how would you change it? What could you do to positively affect that change?
First, is poverty. It's oppression. Everyone is a slave to the dollar, so that puts everybody on a rush. So with you being on a rush, you might be in a hurry. You might not be able to hit that gas, hit the brakes soon enough to be able to not catch that red light ticket. Which you didn't check with the people to see if that worked. It's so many different divisions of sabotage going on right now in this city, and all of those things make the people mad. You be pissed off that you got a ticket that you didn't deserve, and you taking it out on somebody else in traffic. There's just so many different things that's going on. Pat downs, police been doing pat downs for years. I'm on record for suing the police for racial profiling and harassment, and I won. I sued the police from years of being harassed, so this is nothing new. The police have been like that. It's never been a relationship between the police and the people, and even now, they still don't have things in place to show that the police commune with people. And if we had our own police, it would seem more like security or protection opposed to policing. That's what they do. They police us. They don't secure us. They don't protect us.
So how do you bridge that gap between the police and our community?
Somehow, picking our own. We need to be able to pick our own power. We need to be able to elect our own power. And that's the thing right now. It's like, we have to respect life first, because your life has to be just as important as the next person's, and meaning not willing to waste no life. That's the All Lives Matter. But first of all, before we get to Black Lives Matter, we have to get to Black Life Matters, meaning the things that Black people go through that white people don't go through.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? So we have Black Life Matters.
Could you expound on that when you say the things that Black people go through?
Black, meaning you just being pulled over just because you're driving this car. And how did you get this car when we know that there's a system set up to where you shouldn't be riding like this? I mean, that's the subconscious programming in a white person's head. He's getting paid $55,000 to $70,000 to work, and he probably still doesn't have the car that you have. And they wonder, how did you get that? We know, behold, this, first of all, this is a no black, the NBA is no blacks allowed. This is a no blacks allowed country. We go back to the 60s, you got no color this, no color that.
Right.
We gonna be behind if you held us back on everything. So then you hit us with the first black this, first black that.
Right.
You've been holding us back. It ain't that we slow, we just not catching up. You everything is segregated. Chicago public schools, the best example of segregation. The best example, because you got teams that go against each other, but you never ever have anything for them to come together and commune and get to all these brothers. They never get to know each other. Great brothers. All these different schools, tall athletes, and their program already thinking that the only way is a jump shot or just being athletic, a sports ability. We got all this stuff going on in the world. Now they got it turned up on the Olympics. The Olympics turned up. You're looking at ability. What does ability matter when you're not putting emphasis on the body, the person? That person can't do nothing without a body, so we losing lives. You get what I'm saying? So they spend all this money in entertainment when lives really don't matter to them. Just jump. Everything is jump. Go for a dollar.
Let me
Everything
ask you a question. Go. What do you feel about them calling it Chirac? Is that disrespectful?
Yeah.
What do you feel about that? You know what I mean? We don't live here, so.
It's not a lot of people that claim that. It's not a lot of people that claim Chirac. Chirac is... I'm still not accepting. There's a lot of people that's anti-Chirac.
Right.
That's sabotage too. That's paid for. That's right. That's propagated.
Right.
It's propagated because once you give those people that, because it's a whole group of I'm a mentor, so it's a whole group of children that know that they probably not gonna make it to see the summer. I seen kids posting on Facebook. Yeah, I know this summer. This probably my last summer. They're almost intrigued with death, but it's. Man,
it's glorified. The lifestyle is glorified.
It's like, how do we get past that? But no, the whole Chirac thing, I'm not accepting it. I'm not accepting it. And a lot of people aren't accepting it because, I spit poetry.
Mm-hmm.
I say, stop killing us. That's to my brother, only brother, because we got to shut the earth. If jail is better go, funds to build them available. 10 years later, where will we be? With heroes gone, drill, HIV, and trap in place. Just multiple forms of birth control. Big light is to burn the cord. World Star clearly airing on Eric phone stores, but no plans to get out the hood. No hoodies allowed unless the Klan returns. Reloading clips. Our clips on World Star. Why not, says the officer? You get what I'm saying?
Right.
It's apparent, man.
Is there a school in Chicago that is good? It's a black school it's a positive school, something like that. Or do you feel as though all the schools in Chicago really are just broken down and need restructure?
If there is a school that's great and that's more nurturing to us and our culture,
yeah,
it's not promoted in media wise, so we wouldn't know about it and or we wouldn't have access to it,
right.
And it would be so exclusive that maybe you would need certain type of funding to get in here, or it's not enough refuge for the problem children. We're not talking about the ones that want to learn. We're talking about the ones that need help, the ones that's pissed off and don't know why,
right.
and it take years for them to understand why they're mad. Oh, it's because I didn't have my daddy.
Right.
It's a lot of them don't even know why they mad. I didn't have my father in my house, and I didn't know why I was mad until I had to keep on getting sat down. Like, why are you so mad? Oh, because I ain't got my daddy.
Right.
Missing something. So now you feel like somebody else got an edge on you, or why didn't he want me, or why didn't he love me? You know, you feel like we already started behind, and with them, they doing a sweep, taking all the fathers out
right.
the home, and then putting the mother in charge, and she don't have an answer. All she can do is lean on the judge, lean on the injustice system to a black man.
Now,
she teaming up with the white man.
Now let me ask you, who needs fixing first, the police or black people?
Blacks. You got to, because we got to lead by example. Because when we do it, we got to unite. Like when Farrakhan had that thing, justice or else.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, man, we can't aim at the police yet until we can assemble properly, until we can get together and you can see us stand strong. Yeah, Muslims get together, they do this and that. But I don't really be wanting to hear all that because it's crazy around the mosque. First of all, your first place of sign of symbolism should be that the mosque is sacred. It's sacred around there. Clean up your backyard first. The mosque is crazy. It's crazy all throughout here. If it's crazy outside the church, right, that means you see that pastors are playing a role of, you know, you heard the saying, whereas the devil say, all right, you don't come in my house and I won't come in yours. Pastors don't come outside. They don't get out and show their power. They ain't saying, no, we outside. We going to show our... They're not a sign of God's power because they're not getting out using God's power. They stand in the church under that... Man, they sleep. Church is asleep, man.
So let me ask you a question. What's the first solution Chicago needs to see? And whether it's the west side, the south side, what do our people need to see that's in the poverty?
The DJs got to make the first stand, bro, to change. It take the DJs. The DJs.
I never heard that answer before. DJs, why you say that?
Because the DJs are the first peddler to the music. You hearing the music is nothing but suggestions. It's subconscious suggestions. It's theme music. It's lifestyle. It's soundtrack. They got this movement called Put the Guns Down. Mm-hmm. You saying Put the Guns Down. Put the Guns Down, Chicago. You tell them Put the Guns Down, but you're not giving them an alternative. But right. Guess what? All the songs talk about nothing but ratchet. And the DJs are the ones that's peddling it because they're getting paid for it. So the first person that need to be held accountable and the first ones guilty is the DJs. DJs, man. Because they the ones bringing that filth. You would never hear these songs unless the DJ brought it to you. You wouldn't hear about this dude that's in another town talking about something that does not benefit us whatsoever. This music does not benefit us. And they still playing songs. They'll say, Chicago, put the guns down. And they'll put on... Chief, another song, throw your guns up. First thing dude saying the verse is, he got his 9 with him. I got this with me. I'm riding with my AK, this right. And that. DJs first. That's what I'm saying. DJs first, and the people got to follow because they got to see that the radio is in accord. The radio is supportive. All the radio killing us, man. The radio is the first place to poison us because they taking orders from the industry, record labels.
Couldn't we just turn the radios off?
Yeah, but it's still going to be there because some people want to write it off as entertainment. Oh, that ain't hurting me. That ain't doing nothing to me. Yes, it is, because these are the suggestions. These are the only... You're not getting great advice nowhere else, so do a ratio of what good advice you're getting, what bad. If you listen to bad music all day and it's programming these girls to be thoughts and hoochies and this and that or whatever, the radio is killing us, man. I'm telling you, it's the music. The music is killing us. It ain't giving us no nutrients. It ain't giving you no plans to get out the hood. It's everything that's going to get you locked up. And that's more perpetuation for the prison system and stocks. Free labor. All right?
Any last words you want to say, bro?
Man, I love people. I love everybody. You know, I feel like everybody, since we bleed the same blood, we carry oxygen, everybody got to sit on the toilet, handle that same business, and it all smell the same. We got to hook up on the same accord, and that's love.
I used to live 5 blocks from Utah.
Okay.
Right there where they got all the college, got all those buildings, where the little fire station is Roosevelt, near Racine.
Okay.
It used to be public housing right there. I lived there until I was in 4th grade. Then we moved to the hundreds. Well, when we moved to the hundreds, you know, it was nice, quiet. A lot of hundreds are called the Wild Wild Hundreds because, you know, lots of people from the low end are now in the hundreds. Then when they tore down the rest of the projects, you know, like Cabrini Green and Robert Taylor and all of that, and they started having, you know, what they call Section 8, where you could basically move. So then that just spread the low-income people all spread out all over the city. So it's where you used to have middle class neighborhoods and poor neighborhoods. You don't have those no more. It's every neighborhood is a mixture of middle class people, upper class people, and poor people because they spread out.
Well, let me ask you this then. So would you say that crime is worse now, or is it worse back then?
I think it's worse now than it used to be. And I think a lot of it is because when I was growing up, kids had places where they could go and they could hang out. You know what I'm saying? They had community centers. They had the Boys and Girls Club.
NBC.
There's not even too many YMCAs around anymore.
Right, right.
So, you know, you 10, 11, it's the summertime, you out of school, you ain't got nothing to do. So, you know, when people don't have nothing to do, they find trouble to get into. They start out with little trouble, and it leads to bigger and bigger trouble, you know, and I think a lot of it has to do with the fact now that, I hate to say it, people are having kids at a younger and younger age, you know what I'm saying? And a lot of people, they had kids at 16, 17, they still out doing their party thing. And where their kids at? With their mama or some other body who really ain't paying much attention to them, you know?
So with those
folks don't want nobody saying nothing to their kids no more. When I was growing up, if you got in trouble down on the corner, the lady on the corner was going to whoop your ass. And by the time you got home, if you lived on the other corner, everybody on the block knew what you had did. And they telling you, go on home because your mama going to whoop. Now, right. somebody's child do something, you say something to their child, then people telling you, mind your own business. Don't be, you know, don't hit my kids, don't talk to my kids, you know. They don't, and a lot of parents don't whoop their kids no more because they scared of reports of right. child abuse.
So what do you think would be the solution to those problems?
Solution to Chicago's problem.
We need more things for the youth to be involved in. They need more stuff for the youth to get involved in so they can see that there is a better life than the life that they live in now. People need to stop labeling every little black child they see as a gangster or hoodlum or a thot. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Every time somebody see a boy walking down the street and his pants is hanging, he's automatically stereotyped as being a certain type of person. And black and white people do it.
Now let me ask you a question.
They stereotype these kids,
yeah.
You know, and then because you stereotype, you know, they see five little boys walking down the street, they pants, oh, they ain't up to nothing but no good. How you know they up to no
right.
good?
Right. Since you said you grew up in the suburbs of Chicago.
No, I grew up in the city
in
of
the
Chicago.
City of Chicago.
I moved to the suburbs 17 years ago.
So since
I'm 58
been,
years old.
Okay, all right. So you've seen a lot. You've seen
I've
a lot.
Seen a
all
lot.
Praises. Since you've been living in the suburbs, how's it been living in the suburbs?
It's changing. The suburbs is becoming like the city. My block that I live on, everybody used to own their house. It's probably only 3 or 4 people on that block who own the house that they're staying in. Rest of them are being rented.
Do you feel safe where you live? You like the neighborhood?
Only reason why I feel safe is because I've lived in the neighborhood long enough that most of the people know me. They know who my kids are. And they like, you know, that's Peanut's mama. That's Miss Brody. Don't mess with Miss Brody. Miss Brody don't play. Because when my boys was growing up, every last one of their friends who came to my house knew, if you came to my house and you got out of line, I was going to whoop your ass. I didn't play with the kids. I had 2 sons.
Yeah.
And all their friends would hang out at my house, but they knew if you got out of line, Miss Brody was going to get you back in line. If you didn't want Miss Brody reprimanding you, then don't bring your ass to her house anymore.
Your 2 sons, do you like what you've done with them? Do you like what they've become?
You know,
I know that's a personal question. You don't even have to
ask. It's kind of hard because, you know what, I look at them one way and other people say, oh, your sons, they so respectful. They so this, they so that.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, wait a minute, you talking about him? They're like, oh, yeah, we asked them to do something, you know. They don't have no problem. They say yes, ma'am, and yes, sir. But when they at home, they don't do that kind of stuff. So I don't see the same child that other people say. But most people say when they look at my boys that they can tell that they were raised in a good household.
Right.
I was a single mother, so I did a lot by myself, but I was lucky I had my daddy around and I had my mother like I say, it's a combination of a whole lot of things.
So
question. Black folks need to stop worrying about just what's going on in their house and be more unified. Everybody's so busy trying to get their piece of the pie, they not trying to help nobody else to get a piece of the pie. And like I tell everybody, the 50s, the 40s, when black folks was united, before all this segregation and everything took place, black folks was a whole lot better off. Everybody took care of each other. If somebody on their block, on the block left, lost their job, all the neighbors found a way to help feed that family. Nowadays, people don't give a shit about nobody else. All they care about is what's going on in their house.
One question.
The only reason they care about somebody else's house is when the neighbor buy a new car, now they want a better car than the one their neighbor got.
What year did you see that change? Is it the 80s when crack came? That's when everything just got, or before that? When did everything change? Morals.
I think it was a gradual change.
Okay.
I think it was a gradual thing, starting, say, like the mid 70s, and it just got worse from there. Whole lot of shit happened during Jane Byrne and Harold Washington's time. You know what I'm saying? A whole lot of stuff happened during that time that changed a lot of people's outlook on a lot of stuff.
Let the people know who's Jane Byrne and Pearl Washington.
Jane Byrne used to be the mayor of Chicago.
Okay.
She was a pretty decent mayor, you know, but I mean, a lot of people had problems with her. Then Harold Washington came along. He was the first black man. Everybody's like, oh, we got a black man in office. He gonna do this for the black people. He gonna do this for the black people. Well, what happened? The Republican aldermen did everything they could to stop Harold Washington from being a good mayor. Just the same way that Republicans are doing Obama.
Right.
You know, they criticize him, everything he do because he a black man. That's the same way they did Harold Washington when he was mayor of Chicago. He couldn't get somebody's parking ticket expunged, you know, because the Republicans was fighting him all the way. Right. Then see, I think when it comes to that, the government has a lot to do with it.
Mm.
You know, it's so easy nowadays to be accused of child abuse. You know, if you whoop your child and your child goes to school with a weapon on it, then they want to investigate your whole family because you whooped your child. I got plenty of ass whoopings when I was a child, excuse my language.
So,
but the school with whips on me lots of times. It did not turn me into a violent person. It did not. You know, but now you let your child go to school with a weapon on them, they want to investigate you. My granddaughter fell down the stairs, knocked out four of her front teeth. She was 4 years old. What they do with my son, them took her to, they snatched her out of her mama's dead and daddy's hands and took her in a back room. My son walked into the room. Luckily, my granddaughter is the type, she speaks up for herself. When my son walked in the room, he heard my granddaughter telling the lady, "Now you got it twisted. That ain't the way it happened. I told you I fell down the stairs." They were trying to convince my granddaughter to say that her mama and daddy had done something to her.
And why do you think they're doing that? Is it about money?
I don't know. I don't know what it is about. You know what I'm saying?
Because people
I really
are saying the same thing you're
is,
saying,
you know,
in Atlanta, in New York,
you know,
in Detroit.
They tried to find a way to
break up black family structures.
I think so.
What is it about us? Why us?
Like I told my son a long time ago, I really believe that white folks are scared of black people because they know we're smart, we're strong. We have a lot going for us. We have a long history of things going for us. So as long as they can keep us down, then they can just keep on walking over us. You know what I'm saying? And then it's still too many of us who still have that slave mentality. You know what I'm saying? It's too many of us who are still afraid of white people and the establishment to stand up and do the right thing. Oh, no, we do that, we gonna be in trouble. So fucking what? Whether you gonna be in trouble whether you do it or whether you don't do it. So do what you feel in your heart instead of doing what you think the white man wants you to do or what you think the government wants you to do. The government needs to get out of people's personal lives. They really do.
Chicago's first problem, is it the police or the black people in it? Is it the young black man that's acting wild, or is it the police? Who needs to change first?
It's a combination of both. Both of them need to change. They need to change their attitude toward each other. Black people have a certain mindset when it comes to police, and the police have a certain mindset when it comes to black people. So both of them together need, one can't change,
right,
and the other one stay the same. They both need to change. So don't say you do it first and then I'ma do it. No, they need to say, okay, I'ma put mine down. We're gonna put ours down together. You can't have one do it without the other. They gotta do it together.
Oh, crazy.
And if one ain't willing to do it, then you know what I'm saying? It ain't gonna never happen.
Thank you.
But it's gonna take the old black folks to get the young black folks to act.
Open up the book of Genesis, now begin the way you read about our lineage. The song of black, Spanish, native Indians. We was really made to boot the pen. We committed iniquities until it reached the heavens. Captivities of other nations, we were headed. Babylon the great till it's damn illustrated. The only way out is to keep God's commandments. The only way out is to keep God's commandments.
Officer Zakar here from the Orlando camp. We down here in Chicago, great go to the Bud Billiken parade to the Chicago Blitz of 2016. As you can see behind me, we got some of the brothers here that are ready to go to war. And we're going to try to bring some repentance down here to Chicago, which is the murder capital of the world. It's the spirit of hatred down here. A lot of people have never heard the word, and it's true. So that's why a lot of this is going on. But Lord willing, the spirit of the Most High descends upon us, and we can bring repentance to at least one brother, one sister out there that wants to change their life. Stay tuned for the video. You don't want to miss it. Shalom.
We here in America serving captivity. If we God's chosen people, why the hell we on the bottom? Why our young men get shot down? Why are women walking around like video vixens, breast out, butt out, all of this? Why is this happening? Right. God got the answers. Read that.
3 and 8.
The book of Baruch, chapter 3, verse 8. Behold, we are yet this day in our captivity.
So newsflash, although we think that we free as a people, we not. You know how you not free? Because you was brought here as slaves and you ain't went back to the place they brought you from. You still a slave whether you like it or not. They have given us the illusion of freedom. You know what that illusion of freedom is? How this is mystery Babylon? You think your vote counts. You think that you got a hand in picking the president. When has ever any president, including President Obama, done anything for black and Hispanic people?
The last president that did anything was the one that they killed when they took over America.
When they took, you talk about Abraham Lincoln?
No, when they killed Kennedy, that was a coup.
He didn't do nothing for us. You know why? Because we still in the same condition we was during the time when he lived.
Well, the first thing we haven't
still
done,
suffering as a people.
Wait a minute. The first thing we haven't done, we haven't contested the 13th Amendment.
Listen to this. The reason why I'm saying it, said God said, behold, you are yet this day in your captivity because you think you're free, but you ain't went back to where you came from. So those amendments, those laws, is the reason why you don't know that America is the mystery of Babylon that it's talking about.
The mystery Babylon is a
The book of Baruch, chapter it's 3, Arabia, verse 8. Behold, we are yet this day in our captivity, where thou hast scattered us for a reproach and a curse, and to be subject to payment.
To be what?
To be subject to payment.
Who pay more bills than black folks? We got bills out the wazoo. We only want to open the mail sometimes because we know, dang, it's another bill. And they done caught up with it. God said you subject to those payments. Only a slave has to pay back things. If you ruled everything, you would already have control of it already. You ain't gotta pay nothing back. Right. Guess what? America don't pay nobody back.
That's right.
They print money. They print their own money. That's how we know that they not in captivity, but the people that make payments, we are.
They print everybody's money.
Read on. For a reproach and a curse.
Read on.
And to be subject to payments according to all the iniquities of our fathers. Which departed from the Lord our God.
So the reason that you blacks and Hispanics are serving captivity here in America is because you have departed from your God. You know one way you departed from your God? You don't see nothing wrong with wearing an Egyptian ark.
I am Egyptian. I am Egyptian. I am Egyptian.
Huh?
I came from Egypt.
Now you Egypt? You just told him earlier. Now listen.
All of those that are Egypt,
the same
Israel,
place.
We all
Exodus 11, Syria, now listen.
All the same.
You just told us that you was an American black, your forefathers got right here, right?
Came
so God
like,
said
like
you
Noah,
Egyptian.
Like,
God said
like
you
Noah drew our leaves there.
Listen.
They took us like sardines.
God
they
said you an Israelite from the tribe of Judah.
Well, let me say something to you first.
Not Egyptian.
I understand you're pushing it. Let me hold it for a minute.
Because the Egyptians never went in the slave ground ship.
Hold it for a minute. Number one, we know in part, we see in part.
Well, we know we came here on slave ships.
Wait a minute.
That's
history. Wait a minute. Listen.
That's history. I don't know that anymore.
Hold it for a minute.
Go ahead.
Hold it for a minute. We were already here.
Who was?
We were.
Who's we?
Our people, this color, this right here. We were already
brown
here.
Brown people were here. Guess what? Because the Native Indians are your brothers.
That's right.
Israelites, they was here already.
Listen.
You wasn't.
Wait a minute.
You got brought here on the ship.
Can I finish?
Now go ahead. Because I just answered
that. Wait a minute. Hold it. The man that put George Washington in office was a black Moor who was the 9th president of this country before he became the United States.
I know, you're talking about John Hanson. John Hanson.
All right. He single-handed, everybody ran because the whites threatened the Senate and the Congress. Nah. They ran for their life.
Now, with all that being said, all right. What does that got to do with you wearing an Egyptian unk knowing you're an Israelite?
Number one is this. Let me tell you. This right here. This symbol right here represents something that deals with sciences that we have forgotten.
Okay, I'm going to show you what God says about it. The book of Leviticus, chapter 18, verse 3. If you think you're an Egyptian, if you're into Egyptology, if you think you got some knowledge, and you're an Israelite, a so-called black and Hispanic, God says this in the Bible about your Egyptian beliefs.
18, verse 3. After the doings of the land of Egypt,
of what?
Of the land of Egypt,
the physical land of Egypt, who had that unk on the hieroglyphs, you can see them wearing it. Yeah. Read on.
Wherein ye dwelt,
we were slaves in Egypt. Read on.
Shall ye not do?
You what?
Shall ye not do?
Thou shalt not do after the history. Egyptian.
That's a false history.
You shall not be wearing the Egyptian unk. That is not. Joke. Give me Habakkuk 1 and 18
you
now.
You shall not be
wearing that Egyptian unk, sir.
No, I'm going to continue to wear that. I had the cross first.
So now.
Then I realized what the truth was.
Now the cross came. Now listen. The Egyptian unk came first, right?
Yes, it did.
And then the Romans took that from them and made the cross, right?
Yes.
So you went from some Africans who you ain't that had you in slavery to then you had on a cross, which the white man did, had you in slavery because of this reason. Read it.
The book of Habakkuk. Chapter 2 and verse 18.
Uh-huh.
What profiteth the graven image?
The graven image, thing that is made.
The graven
right
image is that
the maker thereof have graven it.
The maker thereof has made the maker that made the earth is the Egyptians.
Graven image means the molten
image. The molten image. They melted that down. That's made out of metal. They melted it down and made it into an Egyptian ark, right?
And a teacher of lies.
The Egyptian ark is a what?
A teacher of lies.
It's a teacher of lies that makes you think you're African. It makes you think you're Egyptian.
Right, bring it out.
It's a teacher of lies when you are actually the Israelites that the Bible speaks of.
That's right.
That's what God says.
Hold on for a minute. Read on. What Dr. Shelby just said. Dr. Shelby said, I think
and a teacher of lies.
I am African.
That the maker of his work trust him.
You trust in that.
All right, do you know?
Let me ask you
this. Let me ask you.
You don't.
No, listen. The power. Wait a minute. The power comes from within.
Well, you say that's like another. You kind of like the inner being, the outer being. Right?
Symbolism is the only religion. Yahshua said this. He said the kingdom of heaven is within.
Explain that. Symbolism is the only religion. What does that mean?
That means that inside everything that you see represents symbol. Every symbol emanates an energy out of it that makes whatever you are possible. This is what symbolism is. But this right here.
I'm gonna show you a symbol. Numbers 14.
The power is within you. Matthew 22.
Everything's
24.
A symbol. Another word for a symbol is what, sir? What's another word for a symbol? Sister, you know another word for a symbol. Make it plain to the people. Another word for a symbol. That's the actual symbol. What's another word for symbols? Another word for symbol is sign, right? Numbers 14 and 11. Another word for symbol is a sign, right? God got the answer for
that
too.
Let me ask you something. Let me ask you.
The book of Numbers, chapter 14, verse 11.
Bring it out.
And the Lord said unto Moses, how long will this people provoke me?
Uh-huh.
And how long will it be ere they believe me?
Uh-huh.
For all the signs.
How long will it be before this people believe me for all the what?
For all the signs,
all the symbols,
which I have showed among them.
Ain't God showing us that he's mad as hell with us right now? He's letting us get gunned down in the street.
That's right.
Young black men are dying at alarming rates. Those are signs for you to wake up.
Yep.
God is mad. Hosea 5:15. Those are signs. Those are the symbols that you ought to be paying attention to as a people. But what our people do,
Hold on, let me talk about everybody.
What happens is, when you see those signs and those symbols that God is showing you, you turn around and act like you didn't see it.
No,
that didn't happen. No, everybody loves us. When they gunning you down the street, they got you in the projects.
Bring it
they are poisoning your water. Hey, y'all act like in Flint, Michigan, the government wasn't poisoning the water of the people in Michigan on purpose.
But our people talking about you won't change. You don't want no change.
Right.
But hey, how many of y'all voted for Obama? Obama from Chicago. Chicago ain't did a damn thing for Chicago.
Right.
Hell, you mean talk about some damn change?
Right.
Y'all the third most dangerous city in America.
Right.
Hell, and who you a danger to? You ain't a danger to the white man. He ain't scared of you. You ain't a danger to the Chinese man. You a danger to your own damn self.
Right.
You wiping each other out.
Right.
For real, you hate each other.
Right.
But you say you love God.
Right.
Be together. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 11. Have a nation changed their God? Y'all say have a nation changed their God? Have a nation changed their God? The Japanese still worship the Billiken, still worship the Buddha. The white man still worship Caesar Boomjah.
Right.
The Greeks still worship their Greek idols.
Right.
The East Indians still worship Krishna.
Right.
Have a nation changed their gods? No, they ain't changed theirs, Reed. Which are yet no gods. They ain't no gods. They ain't idols. We got the one true God on the planet Earth. God is only dealing with us.
Right.
Now, people are being punished. Why? For the iniquities, for the sin, for their sins and the sins of their forefathers.
Right.
Read. But my people, he said, my people, God ain't talking about everybody. God got a people.
Right.
Mine is possessing. When I say this, my sign, you gonna come up and try to take my sign?
Right.
For real, he said, my people, God is possessing. He got a people, read. But my people have changed their glory. He said, my people changed their glory. His people have changed their glory. You changed your God, Reed. For that which does not profit. For that which don't profit you for a damn Billiken.
Right.
What has the Billiken did for you? Somebody bring luck and peace. It ain't no damn peace in Chicago.
Right.
Go right back to where you was at. It ain't no peace here. Hey, man, I'm telling y'all, I'm coming out here to give you to you raw and uncut. I ain't gonna be around the bush and play with y'all.
Right.
Cause I'm ready to get up out of here. I'm ready to get up out of this captivity.
That's
I'm tired of the white man ruling over us. I'm tired of the Chinese man ruling over us. I'm tired of these nations ruling over us when I know we stronger than them.
Hey,
when I know we stronger than all nations on the planet Earth.
Right.
Give me Hosea 4:1. Hosea 4:1. See, that's the problem with our people, hatred. Give me Leviticus, not that Leviticus 19 and 17.
Bring it out!
Every year, want to fight, want to shoot, and want to kill each other. Every year, read what you got. Leviticus 19 and 17. Yeah, hook me up, bro, appreciate it. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy heart. The problem with our people in Chicago is hate. You hate one another. You know what? I'm going to tell you something. If you hate your brother, give me that in 1 John 3:15. Y'all hate each other. Every year you fight. Every year you arguing over some stuff. Look at that. And look. Cut that out. Look. See? Look at that right there. That's hate. Read what you got. Leviticus 13 and 13. Read what you got. 17. Read.
Leviticus chapter 19, verse 17. Thou shalt not hate the thy first son. Chapter 3, verse 15. Whosoever hated his brother.
God said, whosoever hated his brother. That's the problem with y'all blacks and Hispanics, especially our women. This is how our young daughters act. These are our young daughters. These are the future mothers of our children right here. They full of hate. And why is they full of hate? Because nobody ain't teaching them and showing them how to be a woman.
Right.
Read that again.
Whosoever hated his brother.
God said, if you hate your brother, read.
Is a murderer.
God said, if you hate your brother, you a murderer. Look at that. God said, give me that. Give me that in Isaiah 59. Give me that in Isaiah 59. It's time for our people to wake up, man, and repent. Look at that. Look, they quick to run to evil. God got y'all to a T. Start Isaiah 59 and say, read, listen.
Isaiah 59, verse 7. Their feet.
God, look, this is talking about the Israelites. You can't tell me that this ain't the Israelites right here. God said, their feet, read.
Run to evil.
Their feet run to evil. Just beat the hell out of each other and run and look at it. But you know what? This lets you older people know. You have failed your kids. These your children. These your children. Oh, yeah, they your children. Your damn child might not be out here right now, but they might be somewhere else doing it.
Right.
Read that again.
Their feet run to evil.
God said their feet run to evil. And you know what? I'm going to tell you the problem with our people. When they see our people in this midst of iniquity, they sit up there and say, it ain't my problem. Them ain't my kids. Guess what? We hate each other.
Right.
That is our damn problem.
Right.
These
right.
The kids that stay in our community. Tell our people to wake up.
So, sir, since you, how long have you been in Chicago?
all my life.
And so, in your lifetime, what are the changes that you've seen when you were growing up as a kid up until now?
None at all. I mean,
there's always been violence?
There's always been violence, you know. Jails overcrowded, and actually we're dealing with some condemnation.
Were you around the time when Fred Hampton was doing what he was doing, trying to set things up? Were you around during that time?
Yeah, I was in my team.
Wasn't Chicago better around that time?
Well, we had a little bit more more father figures, you know, a little bit more, I would say, respect for one another.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
All right, all right.
And things have changed. How much have things changed from then until now concerning that?
Well, actually, you know, it's just no respect, period, you know. It's like degradation, humiliation.
From the youth?
Yeah. I mean, they have their death wish. You know, no father figures, nobody to, you know, hey, to support them, you know, period, you know. And like I said, we a lot of people appear to be doomed, you know, condemned, you know. So when they condemn themselves, you know. They condemn themselves, they condemn others too, you know. They're death wish, you know, no hope.
What's the solution to black on black crime?
Put more emphasis, man, on suffering, help, you know, and people that's I need, you know, period, you know. I mean, because see, what's going on is that, hey, Chicago, America itself just drives on, feeds off, matter of fact, it feeds off the poor, period, you know, and actually, you know, America is sold out, you know, our people are sold out, you know, and we're against one another, okay. Still from a long way back, you know. Period. You know.
Out here with the young men out here.
Yes, sir.
Shooting, killing.
Yes, sir.
What you think about that from the time you grew up to now?
Brother, life has changed so great since I was born in 35. I don't even know what's going on no more. But I'm old school.
Yeah, I know.
Raised by good parents.
Yes, sir.
Raised in that sanctified Holy Ghost church. I was a Muslim for 5 years and a teacher of Islam was Mohammed. But I couldn't save my soul, so I got away from there.
All right.
But he taught me a lot for a black man in America. I got the white man in the palm of my hand.
Exactly.
Do what I want with him when I want him.
You think things are going to get better without the laws of God?
The Bible says, now the Quran and all that says it's going to get worse before it gets better.
Exactly.
That's all I'm going to answer.
Peace be unto you.
Peace be unto you. All praises due.
Tell him
I made him when he's 76.
Yeah. So, when it comes to a child's mobility, when a child first comes out of the womb, is your expectation for the child to run? No, it has to crawl before it can walk. So we have to systematically change ourselves mentally from start to finish, from the little things to the small things. I can tell how hard it would be for a brother to overcome hard things if he's struggling with the small things. Let's pretend this. Let's pretend that there was a brother that came up right now. He's homosexual. He's been a homosexual all of his life. And God says, man shall not lie with man. If it's hard for him to deal with something very simple, right? Like maybe not shaving his beard. If he always wants to shave his beard, that would be a lot easier for him to overcome than his lifestyle of homosexuality, because he's had that lust spirit on him all his life. We gotta make sure, listen to me now, listen to me good. The same way that when you're a new creature in Christ, you're a newborn child, we have to take brothers and sisters in our community and show them the basics to help them overcome the greater things, brothers. That's what we're trying to show you. That road ain't got nothing for you. It's my job as your brother to tell you that, because nobody else is gonna tell you that. But if you hate God, you're not going to take it as brotherly love.
Right.
If you hate God, you're going to look at me as your brother and you say, you know what? Why are you hating on me? What this Negro talking about? We're not saying this because we have something against you, brother. We're saying it because we love you.
That's right.
You have to understand, if you love God, you have to apply his laws. And like you said, the application starts in your mind.
Right.
Read.
Romans chapter 12 and verse 2.
Thank you.
And be not conformed to this world.
Now, what does the world say to do? Isn't the world doing all types of things? Adultery, fornications, murder, all of the things that's popular in the world, that's hatred against God. Everything that they've been teaching you in the world, man, has been going against you. Haven't you noticed this in the churches that you've been brought up in? There's been a number one image in most churches around the world. You don't think that there's something behind this? You don't think that there's something to put your mind in a prison system to say, when I see this image, I see God. I look at myself, I see nobody. They look at this image, they call them God. They look at you, they call you a thug. They call you a nigga, they call you a gangster. You gotta now change your mind. Step away from the ways of the world. That's all we've been telling you, brother. We've been saying, take your mind out of the ways of the world, what everybody is doing, and get into what God is saying to do. God is telling you, watch your diet, brother. Listen to me. Even if you were eating everything lawfully, we're still going to tell black people in America, watch how much you eat. Watch what you're eating. One of the main killers in the black community is what? High blood pressure, heart disease, gout, all of these things. Why? Because we have not had a care for ourselves. The scripture says your body is what? Your temple, right? So you got to know the right things to put in the temple. You're not going to put something dirty in the temple. We're telling you to protect your temple, King, because we love you. Now read.
And be not transformed.
Start again.
Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. And be not conformed to this world.
Read.
But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind.
You see that? Now, how does the renewing of your mind start? By applying God's laws. Let me show you that real quick. Philippians 2 and verse 5. I thank you, brother, for listening to what we've been trying to bring out.
Change out here that happened with our people, how people start shooting and killing each other out here, right?
Right.
What do you think the change might be?
Coming back to the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High. That's the only solution, brother.
All praises.
All praises. Long,
the reasoning as to why you think that there's so much tension from the police and the city.
See, I get confused when people start asking me stuff like that, so, I mean, think about, like, you know, what just happened here, you know? And, you know, the people are just doing what they do. They congregate. But if you go to an event on the north side, where it's, like, predominantly white, you ain't gonna see all these cops. You're gonna see all these cameras hanging everywhere, man. Like, it's totally different, you know? And, you know, I always tell the fellas in the neighborhood, like, you know, you're always getting, like, busted for the same shit they do up north, you know? So if you go to Wrigleyville, everyone's smoking weed, everyone's drinking. But when you come to the neighborhood, like, you're doing the same shit, and you're going to jail. They're not. So for them, it's like, oh, you know, these kids are just getting a little. So exactly what she said. So, like, you're supposed to get a ticket.
So with that being said, because you were meeting the upper echelon and things like that, so what do you think the solution would be to bridge the gap between the strife between the two groups?
What do you mean? What two groups are you?
You were mentioning about the how the police were, you know, they're doing the things, they're getting away with a lot of different things. Things that people are getting away with things up north, as opposed to in different places right here. So now my question is, because there's obviously separation somewhere. So how do we bridge the gap between the two? How do we get police to stop oppressing these communities and start being fair with their justice?
I understand what you're saying. So, like, people here have been depoliticized. So, like, once you feel the politicized things, like, that's why people didn't care when they were closing school. Some people did, I'm not gonna say all. But, you know, some people are just like, and, you know, that's just the way things are. You know, my son has that attitude. You know, he's 19 years old. He's like, that's the way things are, you know? I'm
right,
like, that's not the way things are. I've taught you different, but if that's what you believe, then I failed you. I failed you if you believe that, you know? And that's neoliberal nonsense. You know?
But how do we fix it, though?
Politicizing our people. Right? Politicizing everyone, you know?
So who do you think would be more accountable for change? Would it be us, or would it be the police department?
Well, we need to hold the police accountable for what they do in our neighborhood.
And is that what you guys are? Is that what you guys? Tell me a little bit about what you guys are. What you guys are about? What does it mean?
So,
and how did you come up with this idea?
Well, this isn't a new idea. This idea comes from the Black Panther Party.
Okay.
So, community control of the police is something that they've been speaking about. This actually took place back in the 70s in Berkeley, California. So it's already happened.
Okay.
You know, it was mandated by the mayor, not, you know, as a legislation. So once the mayor went to legislation, community control of the police. But here in Chicago, this actually came out of the people's hearings here in Chicago, where people came together and talked and spoke on police torture, police murder, police profiling. So everyone came together and the legislation was brought back up.
Is it really as bad as everybody say it is? Because me not being from Chicago, I already had a preconceived notion of what I thought Chicago was going to be. So is the city that way? Because all you hear is Chicago's bad. This person's dying. This person's this. This person being killed. This person this. Is the city? Is it really that bad?
Well, it's propaganda because, you know, when they start talking about black-on-black crime,
right.
I'm going to tell you right now, there's like harsher crimes happening in Latino neighborhoods. They don't put that on you.
Right.
Like, for example, if you go to the back of the yards right here on 47th by Ashland, okay. Not too far away from here. There's two street gangs there. Not only are they killing each other, they're burning each other's houses down. Does anyone ever talk about that?
That leads to our next question. Why is there an overindulgence in what happens to the African American community as opposed to what happens to the Latino community? Why are our stories not being publicized?
Racism, man. Racism, man.
Shalom, Most High Christ bless. You got Captain Rami. Reflections on Chicago. The question is asked, what do Chicago need to do to change? Being from Chicago, they got to follow the example that I done did, repent. Come up out of the false religions, false education, false politics, false entertainment, sports, all these things that's destroying us. They need to do what we read in Hebrews 2:1. If I can read that real quick. It says, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard. I heard that religion was false, that white Jesus was false. And when I heard it, I looked into it and found out according to the scriptures, it actually is. So Chicago need to take the same steps. They need to take heed to what they're hearing. Hearing what? It's brothers that's out there on the streets. It's brothers that's out there teaching at events, doing flyer missions, having camp all over the city. They need to stop and do what? Listen to what these brothers are bringing out. Is what they bringing out another hustle, another lie? Or is it the truth according to the Bible? So watch this, it says, to take heed, it says, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. And there's many different vices in Chicago to let the word of the Lord slip. Chicago is number one in gang activity, number one in murder and in robbing, all right? A lot of parties, a lot of clubs, a lot of different things that can what? Take you away from what? The understanding of who you are and what's required of you. But our people got to acknowledge one more thing. We read about it in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 17. It says, then my anger shall be kindled against them in that day. Who is it them? It's talking about us, the Israelites. And who was the Israelites? So-called blacks, Hispanics, Native Indians. That's scattered across the four corners of the earth. It says, and I will forsake them and will hide my face from them. So you sit back and wonder, man, how is this happen to Laquan McDonald? How did this happen every weekend or every holiday? High numbers of killing, high numbers of shots being fired. How do we get men luring a young boy into the alley to kill him because they're trying to get back at his daddy. How do we get all this stuff? Where's God at in all these things? It says, and I will hide my face from them, and they shall be devoured, and many evils and troubles shall befall them. Chicago is number one in so many different, the nation know us right now as the number one, it was Murder City, the title of the name for it called Chirac. You watch all these different media outlets like CNN, Fox, they throw up statistics how more folks than died in Chicago than in the Iraq war. Why is this stuff going on amongst our people? Because we don't know who we are, and we have broken God's commandments, and it's a curse on us. And we read about it in the book of Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter. So watch this. This is the key part that we got to get to for Chicago. It says, so that they will say in that day, are not these evils come upon us because our God is not among us? Chicago got some of the most biggest mega churches. A lot of mega preachers. One of the biggest false religions, Islam, the Nation of Islam, headquarters is in Chicago. The biggest Israelite school is in Chicago. But we're still number one in killing. Still number one in every egregious thing. So what they need to do is take heed to the word of the Lord. Stop what they're doing and keep the commandments and repent. And guess what? The most greatest thing is Israel united in Christ is there. We got prophets on and suited and booted in the streets to give righteous solutions, to give righteous medicine to the bad sickness that's going on in Chicago. So what they need to do is the same thing I did. In my sickness, the Most High sent prophets, physicians, that gave me the right medicine. What was the medicine? The scriptures. So Chicago got to do the same thing. Take heed to the scriptures. So with that, we're going to say Shalom, Most High, Christ bless.
Shalom, Most High, Christ bless. I'm Captain Hananiah from Israel United in Christ. At the Bud Biblical Parade, a lot of things were witnessed. A lot of heavy things that I seen that was very heavy according to Bible prophecies. First and foremost, I told brothers when we was out there, I said, the Most High got things in store. The Most High got things he got already in plan that we don't know. And when we go out there, the Most High gonna show us some things. So we went out there. First and foremost, I seen a lot of young men running around. A lot of kids running around with no leaders, no guidance. I'm talking about 13, 14, 15 running up and down, laughing and playing, and they out there with the folly and foolishness. And I was just looking around and I'm saying to myself, you know, I see that's a major problem in Chicago, that the family structure is not there. They depending and looking at each other to lead each other. Children leading children. Like the scripture said, if the blind lead of the blind. You understand? So that's the first thing I seen, I noticed. And while we was out there for a while, a lot of folly and foolishness was going, but I was picking up on some heavy points. And one point I picked up on, like me, I came out the world. So like Captain Shin was dealing with these guys. They was walking past, they sat on a bench and they was listening. So three of them was 19, 18, and 17. And one of them was like 30 years old. It was four of them all together. One was 40 years old. I mean, 30 years old, excuse me. One was 30 years old, but he looked young. So Captain Shin was telling them about the gang banging and being in the streets and getting right for their people and getting that household together and becoming a man and all these things. And the brother was sitting there listening. So the brother told Captain Shin, he said, listen, Captain Shim said, where them young men going? Why are they trying to walk away, boom, boom, boom? And the guy said, don't worry about them too much. Just tell me, because I'm gonna be able to relay the message to them. So I understood 100% what he was saying. He was saying that you let me know the right way, and I'm gonna relay it to them in the way I know how, that we gotta walk in the right way. Sometimes we ourselves can't get to the person. Christ said, one plant, one water, and he get an increase. So Captain Shin was bringing it out, but that man had to reach them young men. Because that man come from their world. That man come from their neighborhood. That man come from their understanding. The way they understand life, that's the way that man had to bring it to them. So Captain Shin was bringing out a lot of heavy points, but that young man, that really caught my attention when he said, talk to me and tell me. And I got a related message back to these young men. So sometimes we think we could talk to people and really get to them, but as long as we get to that one person gonna spread that fire like a wildfire. He the one that's gonna be able to ignite the men and show them that we are the Israelites. He the one that's gonna show them men that we have to walk right. That's one heavy point I've seen about the whole Bill Bulligan parade that was very important to me. He used the scriptures to talk to that man. He used God's words to talk to that brother. And that brother said, talk to me, and I'm gonna be able to relay the message back to the men that was with me. So I know exactly where he was coming from, because I was in that world. They had listened to me more. I mean, a person, if I'm in the streets right now, they will listen to somebody else from the streets more than they would listen to somebody not from the streets, because they don't think they got that connection. They don't think that we know the lifestyle they live in, that we don't know where they coming from. So they need somebody else who's in that world to talk to them a certain way to wake them up. So that was having a good point. But another good point, like I was saying, before we left to go out there, we was explaining to the brothers, most of I got people in reserve. So when we went out there, we brought it in three or four people, said, I'll be watching y'all, I know y'all. Brother came out with the fringes and everything. He said he had the fringes and all on. He said, I've been watching y'all for a while. I went over there to congregate with y'all, but when I went, it was his brother's house, and it was so tight, I had to just be patient and try to wait for y'all to get to school if I could come and congregate with y'all. So I told the brothers before that, I said, brother, most I got people in reserve. So that boosted my faith up even more. When this man came out and said, he been watching, he with us, he sent alms, he just waiting for us to get the building, for he could build with us, for he could grow with us. So the most I was always working. When we think the Most High ain't there, the Most High always there. He always got people there to boost your faith up, to show you that what he's saying is real. He show you that every word in that Bible is true. And another point, when I was at the Bud Millican parade, I seen a lot of these young ladies running up and down and in groups like wolf packs. You understand? There's another thing I seen in Chicago, the women running around as well as the men in wolf packs. You know, they walking by like they don't give a damn about the Bible. Some of them was listening, some of them wasn't. But nobody stood there and really, bringing up no real point of what they doing and why they doing it out there in Chicago. Chicago is a rough town, but you know what? The Most High is rougher. He said he make our heads stronger than their heads. You understand? So that's why we gotta go out there with the clear mind to understand these people being oppressed and destroyed. I seen old lots. I seen alleyways like back in the 90s. They had it where they like trying to destroy the neighborhood where they could come in later on and clean it up and get everything dirt cheap. You understand? But our people don't see that. I see our people out there from, what time we got there? Like 10 o'clock, from 10 o'clock to about 1 o'clock selling food, selling this and that to our people, but nobody edifying our people. Nobody telling our people they wrong. That's why the Most High sent us out there to do it. I didn't get to go last year, but I went this year. And when I went out there, I seen things that I never, ever, ever in my life thought I'd see. The oppression out there, we being oppressed because why? Our situations. We are a product of our community, you understand? You're not being taught nothing, you can't teach nobody anything, you understand? So that's why the Most High gotta send his prophets back in the earth, back in these neighborhoods, back in these communities, to go in there and build our people up, because they've been dependent on us. Them young men was gangbangers, they stopped and listened to us. Why? Because they know something about that Bible is true. They know they got no other way to turn but to that Bible. When they hear the word, the Most High said they're going to stop, and they're going to get the understanding of it, because their teacher's not going to be hitting anymore in the corner. So Bud Millican Parade is it's a place where our people is really cooning, and they really being like oppressed, but they got that Stockholm syndrome on them. So us as Israelites, we can't give up on our people. We gotta go in there and not run from the fire, but we gotta run into the fire. You know, I come from that world, so I can relate to them. I come from that train of thought, so I can relate to them. I come from being in a place where I thought hanging around in the streets, seeing the OGs, getting money, I thought that was a way. You know what I'm saying? But the real way is this Bible here. Us applying, learning and teaching that Bible. So that's what they need in Chicago. Real men like us going out there pushing this truth. And above Pelican Parade, I tell you, at the end of the day, there's a lot of good things, but it was more bad things I seen. Only good thing I seen, like I said, I seen a brother that was in, the brother that was in reserve. I seen the kids running around. They needed leadership. I seen gang members stopping and listen. A lot of old people was cooning. You understand? Not caring about what the kids was doing. So we gotta get to that point where we loving each other once again. Cause I know without love, a neighborhood gonna fall apart. Like the scripture say, where there's no vision, the people perish. And that's why they perishing in Chicago, because they have no vision. You understand? So all praise it to the Most High. I got a chance to go out there. And the things we seen is just the beginning. This is just the beginning. Most High gotta oppress our people and send us out there to heal them. He gotta wound our people and send us out there to heal them. He gotta break them down where we could go back out there and build them up. So that's the things I seen, and that's the things I know about the Bud Billiken Parade, that our people in Chicago need us, and we got a big job to do. So all praise to the Most High for that experience. Shalom.
Shalom, Most High in Christ blessed. This is Captain Shem of Israel United in Christ. We come to you today and to let our people know the importance of the situation that's happening right now in Chicago. Our people in Chicago are in a very, very low estate. It started historically back after Emancipation Proclamation. Many of our people fled north to the cities to seek refuge and jobs. And when they got there, they were met with city plight, and the curses that the Bible speaks of have continued to plague them to this day. Present day Chicago is one of the murder capitals of the United States. It has murders after murders, gang warfare, black hatred, okay, abortions. The epidemics in the black community are at an all-time high. And the Bible bears record and witness to all the things that are happening. I want to share a scripture with you, brothers and sisters. This is from the book of Isaiah. Because many times we look at the unemployment rate for black men and we think that it's something that's going to pass. It's not going to pass. The unemployment rate is so high in Chicago that many black men stop reporting their status. And it's biblical. And I'm going to share this with you. The prophet Isaiah spoke about the brothers in the black men, the brothers in Chicago, and it talked about their condition. I'm going to read the scripture to you. It says, Isaiah 51 and 20. It says, "Thy sons have fainted. They lie at the head of all the streets." And that's what's happened. When you faint, you lose consciousness. Meaning the black men in Chicago, the black men throughout the United States, West Indian, and Haiti, and Jamaica, they don't understand that they're the Israelites. They don't understand that their consciousness towards the Most High's law, statutes, and commandments has fainted. They don't understand who they are, okay? It says they lie at the head of all the streets. You don't see the Arab man, the Chinese man, and the white man at the head of all the streets. You see the black man clocking, selling drugs, out there gangbanging, okay? Looking for the next score, just so he can survive. Okay, these things are happening, they're real. Okay, the Bible bears record to the atrocities and the horrible conditions that our brothers are in, that suffer every day. All right, it says, "Thy sons have fainted, they lie at the head of all the streets as a wild bull in a net." What does that mean? A wild bull is someone, is a strong animal, but he's angry. Okay, and that net is a trap. And he's trapped. So it's comparing the black man, the Israelite man, to a wild bull in a net. And he has power. He's angry. He's powerful. But he's trapped in that net of society, which keeps him in poverty. It keeps him in destitute and desperation. It keeps them to want to kill brothers that look just like him. Okay? And why? Because the black man has left the home. Okay? When you read the letters of Willie Lynch, the black man has left the home. And who's left to raise our brothers? Our young black boys are our single mothers. And when I say black, it's not just talking about black African American, but also Latino Puerto Ricans, Dominicans, okay? Also the Native Americans that you see who live on many of the reservations. Predominantly this word is speaking to the largest population now in Chicago is black men. That's when we say black men, want you to know we're talking about you. I'm gonna read on. It says, "They are full of the fury of the Lord, the rebuke of thy God." Meaning what? God is trying to put us in these conditions so we can turn to him. So we can apply love thy neighbor as thyself, biblically according to the scriptures. And we can now stop the violence amongst each other because we stop that hatred in the mind. When we apply these scriptures on how to deal with conflict resolution, we can go to our brothers and listen. Brother, what you did offended me. When you're reading about Matthew, the 18th chapter, it tells us how to deal with our brother, how to deal with hatred, how to deal with our brother on a level of a non-violent level. It's something that Dr. King and all these other black leaders, including Louis Farrakhan, they've all failed our people because of the fact that they do not have the prophecies, the law, statutes, and commandments as a solution to the problems in the black community. So Israel United in Christ, our name IUIC stands for Israel. Israel is the 12 tribes of Israel that have been scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. The black man is the Israelite. Okay, united meaning we're gonna be united in God's laws, statutes, and commandments. In Christ, Christ is the word of God, and Christ, the black Messiah, will return to redeem the children of Israel. Okay, I know I said a lot in a short amount of time. We will be in your city, okay? We are gonna start setting up in the south side. We're gonna go to the west side. We're going to the east side, the north side. We are gonna provide solutions, biblical solutions, to the complex problems within the black community. And you brothers who are tired of these oppressive circumstances, you're tired of disorganization. You're tired of no understanding of who you are. We have the answers according to the Bible. So come learn this truth. When we had come to the knowledge that the Bud Billiken Day Parade in Chicago, in Cook County, the second largest county in the United States of America with the largest black population, we understood that at this Bud Billiken Day Parade, we would see the vast majority of black folks, the Israelites, there. And when I was there, having served and seen in many inner cities, I saw a spirit in Chicago, a spirit of disunity. I saw a spirit of hatred there amongst our brothers. And I'll give you a prime example of that. When I saw one particular parade that was going by, I saw some young Israelite girls, and they were marching in the parade. You know, our people have a lot of rhythm. They had rhythm and marching, and it would appear that they were together because they were marching in rows. But what I saw that very much concerned me is that every single one of these sisters had literally had a blonde wig on their head, okay? And what it shows us is that they value the beauty of Caucasian standards. And they think they're doing it from a perspective of trying to be different, trying to be creative. But what it is envying their oppressors. For too long we've learned lies. And it's time for us now to understand that the Afro, what they call the Afro, or your natural curly hair is the hair that Jesus Christ had. It's the hair that God the Father has. So why would we want to emulate and represent the people that put us in slavery and kept us down and destroyed us to this very day? It's time that we embrace this Bible. The Bible teaches us that the Israelites, the so-called black men of today, Jesus Christ was a so-called black man. And you read, and more importantly, some of you might not be ready for this, but when you read in Daniel the 7th chapter, God the Father is a man, he's a spirit, but he's a man. And he has hair like wool. The same wool that a lot of you sisters and you brothers don't like. Okay, so we have to come back and embrace who our physical characteristics, who we are, and what nation we come from. And that's the children of Israel. Okay, we can stop the murder rate. We can reduce the murder rate. We can solve problems biblically instead of pulling out guns and killing one another. And it all comes through this Bible. This Bible has the solutions to our problems. And it starts with us acknowledging we're not black people. We're not Hispanics, or we're not African Americans. We're the Israelites, and we must turn back to him and keep his commandments. So for example, I'll give you an example. In Chicago, many murders happen. Yes, they happen because of drugs. Yes, they happen because of gang territory. But many times they happen because of misunderstandings, okay? If I see Christ in you, and I know that you are the people of the book, the greatest people, I'm gonna think twice about doing harm to the greatest people on the earth. But we don't see each other like that. That's where we're divided. Okay, so we come back to this Bible, and that's what we need. That's what IUIC, Israel United in Christ, that's what God has sent us here to do. It's to come out to the ghettos. Christ was from the ghetto. Christ was from a city called Nazareth. Okay, he was not a plush background. Christ came up rough, okay? Many of us have lived in rough areas. We've came up around poverty and tough conditions. So now we're coming back to the same place where Christ told us to come to. Go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And when we come to see our people, we want to encourage them to embrace who they are, embrace their history, embrace slavery, because slavery is the key to the Bible. And once you see these things unfold, you'll know your place as a black man, as a black woman, okay, as a black son or daughter. What you have to do in these last days to prepare, because destruction is coming to this place. Look around you, the signs of the time. Chicago, now more than ever, you need this truth. And we are here as the prophets of the Most High to show you and prepare you how to get yourself right in these last days. Look around you. Israel, it's time to wake up. Shalom.
Is Babylon a great mystery? I show you where insanity lives. It's a calm before the storm, and I know this for sure. They stole everything from us, then they asked us for more. We need more soldiers to fight for the Lord, cause ain't no peace until after the war. Take them, come take what is short.
I'm prepared to ride for my people. Prepared to go to war for my people. I'm prepared to die for my people. Cause we the Israelites, we ready to fight. I'm prepared to ride for my people. Prepared to go to war for my people. I'm prepared to die for my people. Cause we the Israelites, we ready to fight.
I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC. To stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.